The next step in organismal evolution, once you have nice energy efficient cells that can grow large, is to put them together and create some kind of multicellular organism. And how do you do this? How can you actually get a single cell organism to group together with other types of cells like its own? Well, if we accept that the earliest organisms were all single cells, and obviously they did quite well up to a point, then at some point there must have been some incident that made several of these cells get together, somehow combine into a colony, and experience some significant selective advantage. Kind of like the idea of strength in numbers. Now, what is there to this idea of strength in numbers when it comes to the earliest organisms? This is something we should explore. Well, one thing that comes with this strength in numbers business is that each cell from that point on may not have to do all things it would normally do, but it can specialize. Now, you think about that for a minute and you realize that when you build a large company, it is inefficient to have everybody do everything. Instead, what you do is you compartmentalize. You have one part of the company in charge of marketing, one in charge of shipping, one in charge of customer service, one in charge of accounting, and so on and so forth. And that is what allows you to build large companies. It's specialization. That is what's more efficient. Now, this idea of efficiency, remember, is very important. I mentioned it a few minutes ago when I talked about the idea that it's important to have the right kind of energy. If you can optimize your energy, then that is a good reason for natural selection to favor the arrangement. And having a co-op, turns out, is one of those optimizations. Division of labor is what all the large organisms have. In order to become large, we need division of labor. That's why you have liver cells and muscle cells and brain cells and all kinds of other cells, so that not each cell does all things. That is much more efficient than the alternative. And ultimately, it is one of those very simple things that as soon as natural selection picks up on something that can give you an advantage for survival and reproduction, and optimal energy use is clearly something important to survival, then selection kicks into high gear and puts pressure on that feature and favors it to improve it. And so if you're looking at multicellularity, we pretty much know that multicellularity evolved many times in different groups of organisms. And there are still today organisms out there that repeatedly evolve their own multicellularity. To give you an example, if you take a sponge and you pass it through a sieve, then you separate all the little sponge cells out and you let them sit in whatever container you have them, and they will start to move towards each other and they will reinvent the sponge that they came from. So you have these individual cells and they will strive to re-engage and become multicellular. And you can watch that in real time. And they do it every time. They make a whole bunch more little sponges. So multicellularity is not something that has evolved many times. It probably still is evolving whenever unicellular organisms have a reason to get together. So what ultimately is the advantage? Let's say, to start with something very basic. Here you have a unicellular organism. This is a protist, and you can see it has a little locomotory device, a flagellum in the back here, and that's it. Now, if something comes along and eats this protist, that means its survival is curtailed. It is not going to be able to transmit its genetic material to the next generation. That's it. End of. But if that same unicellular protist exists as part of a colony and gets eaten, well, chances are that many of the individuals in that colony are somehow related, because cell division probably occurred a few times, right? And if now you take this one out, some of its genetic material is still mixed in with some of that of the rest of the colony. So that means, even though you lose one, you don't lose all of the genetic material. You don't lose the genetic variation. Over here, it's gone. Over there, it's not. So that would be one thing. Strength in numbers that way. The other thing is, if there's many of you finding food, that's another reason why there may be strength in numbers. And so from the colony, you can then have some form of specialization. Perhaps some of these cells, especially the ones on the outside, are much better at moving. And so in this case, you'd say, okay, there's these locomotor cells, they're the ones with the flagella, and you have food synthesizing cells on the basis here. So maybe these are the ones that make the nutrients available and pass them on to these guys so that they can move the colony, move this early multicellular organism to where there is more food. So you start to have a division of labor, specialization. And then the last thing you can do is you can say, well, in order to move the cell efficiently, we don't really need all of these cells. And so we can sometimes lose a couple of them, and especially if those are the ones that are going to carry on our multicellularity in a different area of the habitat. So you send them out. And that's an advantage, because that way not all your genetic eggs are in one basket anymore. Send them out. And to this day, gametes are the only kinds of cells we send out, in the hopes that if whatever is happening with us doesn't allow more reproduction or more survival, maybe it'll work somewhere else. And that sort of eternal passing on of genes is one of the driving forces in organismal life. And it starts with early multicellularity, because that's what ultimately makes it possible. So multicellularity happened multiple times, evolved multiple times, and it is still the way to go when you look at organismal life today. And that's all we're going to do for today.